Testing audio. Testing. Testing. so short. I'm so short, Soups.
Okay. just...
Feel free to...
Okay. Because my mouth is nowhere near, but it'll pick up, right? It'll pick up, okay. And if it doesn't, tell me. I have a big voice, but just tell me and I will start over, right?
So are these on yet?
Okay, got it. Well, I'm not the only one speaking. Like, my nephew is speaking, but I am the last one speaking, and I am of height. But I hate, for me, that's probably better. But, yeah. To push up, okay, yeah. I'll be the last, yeah. My cousin Harriet is not much taller than me, but Matt is much taller.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. But you'll be up here if I needed to adjust it. You'll be over there.
Well, yeah. I'm going to be standing there, but when you come up to speak, I'm going to sit down.
Okay. All right. Well,
but sure.
If I can't adjust it, someone will help me.
There you go.
I'll keep an eye.
Okay.
Nice.
Okay. Cool. And I don't mind being told that I'm not speaking. I'll get to it. Just tell me. Yeah. I'll, you know, I'll just be like, but I have a very large voice. So.
Well,
I could use the center one, whichever, wherever you think. Yeah, so you just tell Harriet, I'll go wherever Harriet is at. So you tell us. I mean,
there's two microphones.
Yeah. Okay.
So if you want to share, because I'm not much taller.
Right.
So
if you want to, I'm a little bit more comfortable with that, and then I can see the whole crowd. You know? I'm a little bit more comfortable.
Well, that picture could be moving too far off to the side.
It's a little awkward, so I feel like maybe we should all just go to the center. If I don't feel, I defer to you. You tell me what to do.
If that's what you prefer.
I prefer it for the speaking part of it, because I can see everybody. Whereas
probably
here.
The camera is better.
And it's over
for that.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, this is all visible.
Yeah. So, yeah, Harry is speaking. This is Judy, yeah.
So we were just discussing which microphone put up a set of microphones.
But yeah,
Deb is saying
I prefer the center because I can see everybody from here.
Whereas, can get you a little bit.
No, I'm good. I'm good. I might not be able to.
You up when you were facing that way. I was picking up your
voice. Yeah.
Okay. And
so,
my husband, Howie.
He's singing the
chant.
Yeah.
When somebody comes up, I'm going to go sit down.
Okay, and Matt. And I'll show Matt. But
I think that's how.
That's how, yeah.
When you sing, honey, this is the chaplain.
And I think we should not use
this. It's
Judy.
So how, you'll be here, honey?
Just here?
You have this username.
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yes.
I said the only reason I need it was
this makes me happy.
Okay.
That's happy. And then we don't have to adjust it.
Like I said, the only reason we did it was for COVID protocols. And that's not. Tell me they're all vaccinated.
Oh my God. Yeah.
As if
not. Yeah.
Well, they're not all Jews.
But
in my experience, as a competition, I have five.
I got the second one twice.
Do you know they didn't? They didn't.
Right here.
Oh my goodness. I said,
Welcome, everyone. If everyone can please take a seat, we're going to be starting in just a few moments. I'll do Korea. Before we begin, if I could just ask, if you have a cell phone, if you wouldn't mind just putting the cell phone either on the vibrate mode or just turning the cell phone off during the service, we would appreciate it. Welcome, everyone. Today's service for M. Stephen Piver, M.D., will be officiated by Chaplain Judy Henn from Temple Beth Zion. To begin the service, just before we start the service, I'm going to do an ancient Jewish ritual with the immediate blood relatives. It's called Kriya, where back in the day, they would tear the clothing. More people nowadays, we take a ribbon, and I'll say a prayer with the family, and we'll just make a tear. And this is so when the family goes out in public for the next few days, people will know that they have suffered a loss, and I will do that now.
Sim shalom, sim shalom, sim shalom, tova uvracha, sim shalom, sim shalom, sim shalom. Tova uvracha, chen v'chesed v'rachamim aleinu ve'al kol yisrael. Israel, Amecha, Sim Shalom, Sim Shalom. Grant peace, goodness, and blessing, grace, kindness, and mercy to us and to all your people. We're here to celebrate the life of our beloved Dr. M. Stephen Piver. For 87 years, we were privileged to have with us a man who devoted his life to serving others, whose life was full of tikkun olam, making the world a better place. Excuse me. He was a remarkable man and a mensch, a good person. We'll hear more about that in a few moments, but judging by the people here today and all of the ones that I'm told are watching on Zoom, I'm not the only one who thought so. I think this poem beautifully describes Steve's life. A life well lived is a precious gift of hope and strength and grace from someone who has made our world a brighter, better place. It's filled with moments sweet and sad, with smiles and sometimes tears, with friendships formed and good times shared, a laughter through the years. A life well lived is a legacy of joy and pride and pleasure, a loving, lasting memory our grateful hearts will treasure. Death has taken our beloved Stephen Piver. The world is a little darker today, and we grieve his loss. In the midst of this sorrow, may the presence of loving family and friends be a great comfort. Steve's love united you in life, and death cannot break that bond. The companionship you shared during his life continues through the tenderness of memory. The gifts of his heart and mind, which brought joy and happiness, are now a precious remembrance. For all these and more, we give our thanks to God. The 23rd Psalm is a scripture which is sacred to people of many faith traditions. It's printed in your leaflet, so if you would please open your leaflet and join me in reciting it now. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is really such a difficult time. It's never easy to get up and speak about a loved one who has passed. Today we're going to be privileged to hear from Dr. Piver's niece, Harriet Schreier, from his grandson, Matt Ducarne, and from his daughter, Deborah Piver. Harriet.
Good afternoon. To be a Piver is an honor and a responsibility. To live large, love big, worry a lot, and not get much sleep. It's in our bones. We believe it is our path to take care of others however we can. It's been over 100 years since Steve's father, Harry, a milliner from Elizabethgrad near Odessa, and Steve's mother, Sonia Bard, from a town near Kiev, came to the U.S. at barely 20 years of age to escape what was fast becoming the pogroms you've all seen in Fiddler on the Roof. While most of their families settled in the Lower East Side and eventually the Bronx, Steve's parents came to Washington to be new Americans, to speak only English at Piver's Delicatessen. Steve was the youngest and grew up with his older sister, Frances, my mom, and his brilliant older brother, Julius, who was to be the family's first doctor and not the last. When he hit his teen years, the family's financial circumstances were changing. His parents were always working. Steve was alone a lot to fend for himself. He was barely 22 by the time he was an orphan. And when my father, a mentor to him, died unexpectedly at 36 years of age, Steve was really shaken. In a 2-year span, he had lost his father, his mother, and his mentor. It was left to him to tether himself in this world, and it's fair to say that Steve built his life from scratch through grit, Aunt Susan's unwavering love, and the eventual amazing nuclear family that he built for himself. To be loved by that generation of Piver was special and intense. All three of those siblings, Frances, Julius, and Steve, loved fiercely and pushed people to be their very best selves. As they left this world, I was left with questions. When Frances died, I asked, how much will you love? How well will you parent? How much will you sacrifice? When Uncle Julie died, I asked myself, what is your character? What will your name mean? How have you built a community around you? But Uncle Steve's passing is like a question and a challenge all at once. What will your life mean? Did you do your best every time? And did you always answer the call? If being a Piver means living large, loving big, and making the world a better place, Uncle Steve fulfilled that every day of his life. May his memory be a blessing.
Hello. I come here today with a hollow heart, as I just lost a best friend. Steve Piver was a wonderful, loving man, a cancer surgeon who always ensured comfort and safety to his patients, and a passionate lover to all members of his family. He really did it all. He taught me my two favorite things, squash and golf, and I will be forever, eternally grateful for it. May his beautiful soul rest in peace. Papa Steve, I love you. Thank you for listening.
Thank you all so much for being here today, and those of you who are watching on the live stream, thank you so much. It's just lovely to see you. The word eulogy comes from the Greek, and it means praise. And I am here representing my family to praise my father, to celebrate his life and his many, many accomplishments, both professional and personal. Growing up, our father told us that we should find something we love to do, we should study hard, we should become expert at it. And through this work and through our lives, we should help make the world a better place. And this is how he lived his life. He found his calling through loss. With the death of both his parents when he was a young man came the deep desire to help and heal people. He was inspired by Elie Wiesel's belief that we have to go into despair and go beyond it by working and doing for others. He dedicated his life to working and doing for others through treating and curing patients with cancer, through research, through teaching and writing. Our father was the chairman of the Department of Gynecological Oncology at Roswell Park Cancer Institute for almost 30 years. In recognition of all his contributions, Roswell created the M. Stephen Piver, MD, Distinguished Service Endowed Chair in Gynecological Oncology. He completed his career at Sisters of Charity Hospital, where he worked as a senior gynecological oncologist until his retirement at 81 in 2016. His devotion and service were honored in 2010 when the hospital established the M. Stephen Piver MD Center for Women's Health and Wellness. He authored over 400 articles and 8 books. He established an international registry of families with a history of ovarian cancer, named after the late comedian Gilda Radner. He also collaborated on a book, Gilda's Disease, with actor Gene Wilder, Gilda's husband. He loved his work. It was his calling and his privilege to help women and their loved ones facing cancer. He literally saved thousands of lives, and those he could not save, he eased their journey and their fear. He made 2 promises to every patient. 1, I will never let you suffer. And 2, you will never be alone. He continued working and doing for others through his teaching, training countless residents and fellows, modeling what it means to be a caring, effective, humane physician. One of his fellows wrote him saying that the greatest contribution is to use your gifts and talents to uplift, educate, and empower another human being so that they may do the same. Thank you for planting seeds of greatness and allowing me to be one of your seeds. Our father was tireless in his charity and community work. His longest and deepest connection was to the soup kitchen, Friends of Night People, where he volunteered for more than 35 years, eventually becoming chair of the board and leading a successful drive to buy the shelter's building. He helped create a welcoming place that offered hot meals, clothing, counseling, and health services. He never looked away when someone was in need. He said, 2 things I hate in life are greed and human suffering. I can't do much about greed, but I can do a lot about human suffering. When Duville College awarded him its Achievement in Healthcare Award, they said, to be in the care of the gentleman who stands before us this evening is to have known the meaning of hope, understanding, and compassion. My father would want you to know that among his many achievements, he made 2 holes in one at Lockport Town and Country Club. As we tried to prepare for honoring him today, my brother Kenny said, how did one person accomplish all of this? And my brother-in-law Rob's reply, he married Susan. Yeah, yep. That leads me to his proudest accomplishment, which was his marriage and his family. My parents were married for over 63 years. They met in anatomy class at Temple Medical School. She thought he was a hot Greek guy and was mildly disappointed when she learned that he was a nice Jewish boy like she was supposed to date. Right? And his joke was that he had to marry her because she threw off the grade point average by getting A's on every test without ever needing to study. So they made a deal. She would support him during his training, and then she would go back to school, which she did, becoming a healthcare lawyer. They were partners always. My dad began each day saying, there is my beautiful bride. He loved her every day of their 63 plus years together. His pride and delight in his children, grandchildren, nephews, nieces was immense. He was always there to support us medically, emotionally, through sheer force of will, if necessary. Our black lab, Abby, shared the honor with our mom of being the love of his life. Writer Madeline L'Engle says that stories are not our immortality. Our immortality is greater, vaster, but that remembering stories is the best way to have people remain part of our mortal lives. So to close, I will share my father's favorite story. When he and my mom first started dating, he didn't have much money. And he called her one night saying, "I was down to my last dime and I had to choose between using it to buy a Hershey bar for dinner or calling you. I chose you." And as he must have known what happened, she said, "I'm coming to get you." And she took him home and fed him and loved him. As he said, "That was a dime well spent." And a life even better spent. You did good, Stevie. We love you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing those memories. What a remarkable man. You know, we often say when someone has passed, well, he lived a good life. I think he accomplished enough to be, oh, a life and a half, maybe two or three lives. So when I got the text on Saturday asking me if I was available on Tuesday to do a funeral for Dr. M. Stephen Piver, I thought, I know that name from somewhere. Why is that name so familiar? Then it hit me. It was because his name is on the building where at Sisters Hospital where I did my chaplain training. I thought, no wonder I know this name. I saw it every week for 2 years. Then I spoke to Deb and she sent me his obituary and I thought, what an extraordinary man. It's clear to me that the loss of this man is a tragedy, not only for his family, and of course, Abby, an important member of the family, whom he loved dearly, but also for the multitude of people and organizations whose lives he touched. His legacy is one that will not be easily or quickly forgotten, because he made such an impact on the lives of so many people. There's a belief in Judaism that everyone is responsible for their share of tikkun olam, the repair of the world, and I heard that mentioned a couple of times during the eulogies. And it seems to me that Steve Piver made it his mission to do far more than his share. The world is a better, brighter place because he lived in it. When I met with Deb and Bobby, they told me that Desiderata was one of their dad's favorite pieces, so I'd like to share it with you now. Go placidly amid the noise and the haste, and remember what peace there may be in silence, as far as possible without surrender, be on good terms with all persons. Speak your truth quietly and clearly, and listen to others, even to the dull and the ignorant. They too have their story. Avoid loud and aggressive persons. They are vexatious to the spirit. If you compare yourself with others, you may become vain or bitter, for always there will be greater and lesser persons than yourself. Enjoy your achievements as well as your plans. Keep interested in your own career, however humble. It is a real possession in the changing fortunes of time. Exercise caution in your business affairs, for the world is full of trickery. But let this not blind you to what virtue there is. Many persons strive for high ideals, and everywhere life is full of heroism. Be yourself, especially do not feign affection. Neither be cynical about love. For in the face of all aridity and disenchantment, it is as perennial as the grass. Take kindly the counsel of the years, gracefully surrendering the things of youth. Nurture strength of spirit to shield you in sudden misfortune, but do not distress yourself with dark imaginings. Many fears are born of fatigue and loneliness. Beyond a wholesome discipline, be gentle with yourself. You are a child of the universe, no less than the trees and the stars. You have a right to be here. And whether or not it is clear to you, No doubt the universe is unfolding as it should. Therefore, be at peace with God, whatever you conceive him to be, and whatever your labors and aspirations, in the noisy confusion of life, keep peace in your soul. With all its sham, drudgery, and broken dreams, it is still a beautiful world. Be cheerful. Strive to be happy. And so, to his beloved wife, Susan, to Deborah, to Bobby and Rob, to Ken and Danielle, to Ryan and Heather, to Matt, Asa, and Sella, I offer my sincere condolences. May his memory always be for a blessing. Let's take a few moments at this time for some silent meditation as we reflect on Steve Piver and the impact he had on our lives. In the rising of the sun and in its going down, we remember him. In the blowing of the wind and in the chill of winter, we remember him. In the opening of buds and in the rebirth of spring, we remember him. In the rustling of leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we remember him. In the beginning of the year and when it ends, we remember him. When we are weary and in need of strength, we remember him. When we are lost and sick at heart, we remember him. When we have joys we yearn to share, we remember him. So long as we live, he too shall live, for he is now a part of us as we remember him. In the Jewish tradition, there is a prayer recited at funerals called El Mele Rachamim, which means compassionate God. It asks God to accept the soul of the departed and grant him eternal peace. Today, it is my great pleasure to invite Dr. Piver's nephew, Howie Schreier, to chant this prayer. If you are able, please rise for El Mele Rachamim.
El male rachamim shochen bamromim hamtze menucha nechona takhat chanfei hashechina im kedoshim utechorim kuzohar harakia mazhirim Lenishmot Menasha ben Tzvi v'sura Yakirenu shehalchu le'olamam Baal harachamim Yastirem b'seter kanfo le'olamim V'yitzror b'tzror ha'chayim et nishmatam Adonai hu nechalatam v'yanuhu b'shalom al mishkavam v'nomar amen.
Compassionate God, eternal spirit of the universe, grant perfect rest in your sheltering presence to Dr. M. Stephen Piver, who has entered eternity. O God of mercy, let him find refuge in your eternal presence, and let his soul be bound up in the bond of everlasting life. God is his inheritance. May he rest in peace, and let us say together, friends, amen.